And now I shall just read a few, an excerpt from a book by a certain Robert Graves and Raphael Bataille. Excuse me. We will be reading about Lillith. Lillith. Yes, Lillith. But this version of Lillith is rather Hebrew, you understand. Lillith is actually Babylonian. Some say Macedonian. Some say Akkadian. I naturally veer towards the Babylonian version, but right now I'm just reading, you understand? I'm just reading. So mind you, let us read from this excerpt from Robert Graves and Raphael Bataille. From the book, Hebrew Myths. Chapter 10. Adam's help mates. Having decided to give Adam a help mate, lest he should be alone of his kind. Excuse me. God put him into a deep sleep, removing one of his ribs, and he formed this rib into a woman and closed up the wound. Afterwards, Adam awoke and said, "This being shall be named Woman, because she has been taken out of me, who am a man." A man and woman shall be one flesh. The title he gave her was Eve, the mother of all living. Thank you. Excuse me, the light went out. Oh my, this is not good. Okay, I'm back. However, some say that God created man and woman in his own image on the sixth day, giving them charge over the world, but that Eve did not yet exist. Now then, God had set Adam to name every beast, bird, and other living thing. When they passed before him in pairs, male and female, Adam, being already like a 20-year-old man, you see, he felt jealous of their loves, because the male porcupine had a female porcupine lover. The male snake had a female snake. The male doggy had a female doggy. The male elephant had a female elephant. The male orangutan had a female orangutan. Why, everybody in the animal kingdom seemed to have a female and a male companion, and everybody was fucking. Everybody was fucking except Adam. He was not fucking. And he was jealous. He was jealous as the beasts of the field. And so, he tried fucking with each female in turn. And, however, such bestialities did not give him any real satisfaction. Especially one day, he tried to fuck a mongoose. And it was wasn't pleasurable at all. He therefore cried, "Oh God, every creature has a proper mate, but me, I have none." And he prayed to God to remedy this injustice. It was then that God formed Lillith, the first woman, just as he had formed Adam, except that in forming Lillith, he used filth and sediment instead of pure dust. From Adam's union with this demoness Lillith, and with another like her named Nama, Tubal Cain's sister sprang Asmodeus, and innumerable demons that still plague mankind. Many generations later, Lillith and Nama came to Solomon's judgment seat, disguised as whores of Babylon, of Jerusalem. I get quite excited with Babylon, you understand. Adam and Lillith never found peace together, you see. For when he wished to lie with her, when he wished to get to know her, when he wished to copulate with her, when he wished to have a good old roll in the hay, basically, when he wished to have tantric pleasures with her, when he wished to have sex with her, when he wished to fuck her, she took offense at the recumbent posture he demanded, because he insisted that she lie on the bottom while he took the missionary position, you understand. She said, "Oh, hell no. Why must I lie beneath you? I also was made from dust, and I am therefore your equal." You dingbat. Because Adam tried to compel her obedience by force, Lillith, in a rage, uttered the magical name of God, rose into the air, and left him with his dick in his hand. Adam complained to God, "Oh dear, this damn kindle. Adam complained to God, "I have been deserted by my helpmate." God at once sent the angels Sinoi, San Sinoi, and Simangelov to fetch Lillith back. They found her beside the Red Sea, a region abounding in lascivious demons, very horny demons, to whom she bore Lilim at the rate of more than 100 a day. "Return to Adam without delay," the angel said, "or we will drown you." Lillith asked, "How can I return to Adam and live like an honest housewife after my stay beside the Red Sea, fucking just about everybody?" "It will be death to refuse," they answered. "How can I die?" Lillith asked again. "When God has ordered me to take charge of all newborn children, boys up to the 8th day of life, that of circumcision, girls up to the 20th day. Nonetheless, if ever I see your three names or likenesses displayed in an amulet above a newborn child, I promise to spare it." To this they agreed. But God punished Lillith by making 100 of her demon children perish daily. And if she could not destroy a human infant because of the angelic amulet, she would spitefully turn against her own. Some say that Lillith ruled as queen in Zimagard, and again in Sheba, and was the demoness who destroyed Job's sons. yet she escaped the curse of death, which overtook Adam, since they had parted long before the fall. Lillith and Naamah not only strangle infants, but also seduce dreaming men, any of whom, sleeping alone, may become their victim. Undismayed by his failure to give Adam a suitable helpmate, God tried again, and let him watch while he built a woman's anatomy, using bones, tissues, muscles, blood, and glandular secretions, then covering the whole with skin and adding tufts of hair in places. And the sight caused Adam such disgust that even when this woman, the first Eve, stood there in her full beauty, he felt an invincible repugnance. God knew that he had failed once more. Yes, this God, this demiurge, failed once more and took the first Eve away. Where she went, nobody knows for certain. God tried a third time and acted more circumspectly. Having taken a rib from Adam's side in his sleep, he formed it into a woman, then plaited her hair and adorned her like a bride with 24 pieces of jewelry before waking him. Adam woke up entranced. Some say that God created Eve not from Adam's rib, but from a tail ending in a sting which had been part of his body. Oh, was Adam a reptilian? Egad, man. God, however, cut this tail of Adam's off, and the stump, now a useless coccyx, is still carried by Adam's descendants. Others say that God's original thought had been to create two human beings, male and female, but instead he designed a single one with a male face looking forward and a female face looking back. Again, he changed his mind, removed Adam's backward-looking face, and built a woman's body for it. Still others hold that Adam was originally created as an androgen of male and female bodies joined back to back. Since this posture made locomotion difficult and conversation awkward, I can imagine, sir, God divided the androgen and gave each half a new rear, a new ass, a new buttock. These separated beings he placed in Eden, forbidding them to couple.
The tradition that man's first sexual intercourse was with animals, not women, may be due to the widely spread practice of bestiality among herdsmen of the Middle East, which is still condoned by custom, although figuring three times in the Pentateuch as a capital crime. In the Akkadian Gilgamesh epic, Enkidu is said to have lived with gazelles and jostled other wild beasts in the watering place until civilized by Aruru's priestess. Having enjoyed her embraces for 6 days and seven nights, he wished to rejoin the wild beasts, but to his surprise, they fled from him. Enkidu then knew that he had gained understanding, and the priestess said, "Thou art wise, Enkidu, like unto a god." Primeval man was held by the Babylonians to have been androgynous. Thus, the Gilgamesh epic gives Enkidu's androgynous features, the hair of his head like a woman's, with locks that sprout like those of Nisaba, the grain goddess. The Hebrew tradition evidently derives from Greek sources, because both terms used in Tanaanic Midrash to describe the bisexual Adam are Greek, androgynos, man-woman, and the prosopon, two-face. Philo of Alexandria, the Hellenistic philosopher and commentator on the Bible, contemporary with Jesus, held that man was at first bisexual. So did the Gnostics. This belief is clearly borrowed from Plato, yet the myth of two bodies placed back to back may well have been founded on observation of Siamese twins, which are sometimes joined in this awkward manner. The two-faced Adam appears to be a fancy derived from coins or statues of Janus, the Roman New Year god. Anyway, I'll stop now. It would be interesting to find out more about Lillith. I hear she's rather hot. Omaha.